It's election day for many voters across the nation. We'll take a look at what that means for you in the state of Kentucky.
And we'll tell you how much money was spent during the governor's race between Andy Beshear and Daniel Cameron. It's a big day in Kentucky as the leader of the Commonwealth will be elected. Hello, I'm Morgan Luster.
And I'm Alexis Harmon. Welcome to your Wildcat News. We will begin with the big race that people across the country are talking about. It's incumbent Democratic Governor Andy Beshear against his Republican challenger, Attorney General Daniel Cameron. Beshear hopes to win another term in office focusing on the future of Kentucky, while Attorney General Cameron would be the first Black Republican governor in the state of Kentucky.
The Fayette County Clerk's office is also up for grabs. Republican newcomer Don Perkins faces Democrat incumbent Susan Lamb. Lamb was appointed to the position after longtime clerk Don Blevin stepped down. Since taking over, she says she wants to continue the work she has started, but Perkins thinks it's time for a change. Current Secretary of State Michael Adams is facing Charles Wheatley in today's race for Kentucky's Secretary of State. Adams, the Republican candidate, has held office since January 2022 and is running for re-election. Wheatley, known as Buddy, is the former state representative and is running as the Democratic candidate. The Secretary of State oversees elections, records official actions of the governor, and handles various business-related affairs in Kentucky.
The Kentucky Attorney General race is on, with Republican Russell Coleman running against Democrat Pamela Stevenson. The Attorney General serves as counselor to state government agencies and legislatures, as well as a representative to the public interest. We see two new candidates compete for the role of state auditor, often referred to as the watchdog for Kentucky taxpayers. Allison Ball, the Republican candidate, beat her opponent in May and has advanced to her party's nomination, while Democratic candidate Kimberly Reeder ran unopposed for her party's nomination. The primary job this person holds is to audit accounts and transactions of all state government spending agencies.
In the race to become Kentucky's next treasurer, Democrat Michael Bowman and Republican Mark Metcalf are on the ballot. Metcalf is currently serving as Garrett County attorney, while Bowman has a finance background. The Kentucky treasurer is the chief fiscal officer and takes care of revenue, deposits, and unclaimed property.
Kentucky's Commissioner of Agriculture will be a race between Democratic candidate Sierra Inlow and Republican candidate Jonathan Schell. The winner will be taking over for former House of Representatives member and two-term commissioner Ryan Quarles. Governor Andy Beshear appointed Kimberly Baird to serve as the Commonwealth's attorney for the 22nd Judicial Circuit of Kentucky, which serves Fayette County. Baird replaced Lou Anna Redcorn, who announced her retirement in September. A Lexington native, Baird went to Lafayette High School and studied at the University of Kentucky before going to law school. Baird is the first Black woman to serve as a Commonwealth's attorney.
We will find out very soon who the governor of Kentucky will be, but for now, let's just see how much money was spent on the race. Nia Leveretter has more.
This year's election is a crucial one for the state of Kentucky as the race for governor continues between incumbent Democrat Andy Beshear and challenger Republican Daniel Cameron. A big topic to the story that is causing conversation is money. With this being one of the most watched elections across the country, nearly $65 million have been raised this singular election. Political scientist and election analyst Dr. Stephen Voss explains where some of this money comes from.
Both Beshear and Cameron have gotten a lot of their money from people out of state. These days, it's quite common for people to give small sums to far-off elections that they've learned about over social media, over the internet. And that, you know, even if it's small donations, that money can add up. Unlike some races that we've had in Kentucky recently, both Cameron and Beshear are also getting a lot of money from in-state. You know, a lot of money comes out of Louisville into the campaign coffers. It's a big city, for example, and they've received donations from counties all over Kentucky as well.
Recent reports break down the numbers for each campaign to be around $18.8 million for Beshear and $5.35 million for Cameron. So where is the rest of the over $40 million coming from? A lot of that is through other groups not affiliated with official campaigns.
A lot of the advertising you're seeing, a lot of the money being spent, isn't actually going through the campaigns. Instead, outside groups will come into Kentucky and attack either the Democratic or the Republican candidate, hoping to affect the election. Now, if you're bringing in outside money, you're not supposed to coordinate with the campaigns, and you basically can't talk to them about what you're going to say. What that means is Cameron can't control all the attacks being leveled at Bashir, and Bashir can't control all the attacks being directed at Cameron because those attacks are coming from people they're not even allowed to speak with.
Now that we have taken a look at the races across the Commonwealth, let's check in and see how the governor's race and other big issues are being viewed across the country. CNN's John Lorenc has a look at the most talked about topics.
Election Day 2023 features a few statewide races for elective offices, and some cities are electing mayors. Relatively low-key. But that doesn't mean this Tuesday should be glossed over. In Ohio, residents will determine two ballot measures, one that would create a law legalizing marijuana and the other that would enshrine the right to abortion in the Buckeye State's constitution.
There have been six abortion rights ballot measures that have taken place since the Dobbs decision, and in each case, the abortion rights side won in those, so Ohio would be the seventh, which to me is an indication of how popular abortion rights are in this country.
Over in Kentucky, Democratic Governor Andy Bashir is running for re-election against GOP challenger Attorney General Daniel Cameron.
It's a very red state that has only elected, I believe, three Republican governors in the last, like, 75 years.
And then there's Virginia, where voters will decide the balance of power for both chambers of state government.
Historically speaking, the party that wins the state Senate, at least the last few cycles, has done very, very well in the next year's presidential race.
Speaking of 2024, polling from the New York Times and Siena College shows former President Donald Trump is leading President Joe Biden in four swing states, Arizona, Georgia, Michigan, and Nevada. I'm John Lawrence reporting.
Coming up on Wildcat News, Shakers Village hosts their first ever equine festival.
And how one church is changing the lives of thousands of kids. We'll be right back.
The black truck? Hey, Christina from accounting.
Yeah, hi.
Hey, I used to date a girl named Christina.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and then she dumped me for my best friend. You want to see some photos of them that I took?
I don't.
I thought we talked about this, buddy.
Buzz and overshared again?
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm going to call a car.
That's a smart idea.
So, yeah, I know. That's why I did it.
Hey, you're going to get back to the top of the mountain.
Does that mean I'm going to get back with Christina?
No.
Oh.
No.
For most of us, there are no guarantees, no golden tickets, no easy roads. But at the University of Kentucky, there is a promise to support and inspire you, to reach for what's possible, to lead and create, to heal and discover, as we help solve the world's toughest challenges, transforming lives and improving communities. At the University of Kentucky, we promise to make the possible real.
This past weekend, the first annual Equine Festival took place at Shakers Village in Harrodsburg. The fest featured horse-themed vendors, trail rides, and meet and greets with the horses. Equine and Stable Coordinator Sarah Mansfield says that this event was held in an effort to get more people involved in Shakers Village equestrian programs.
It really helps bring the community together. Like, so many people that have horses and own horses didn't know at all about Shaker Village, and they've never been out here, or they have been to Shaker Village and they've never been out to the West Lot area and to the stables, and they just don't know what we have to offer. And so I think events like this that help bring people in and communicate with each other and talk with each other really helps grow that kind of relationship of getting people to have new places to enjoy their horses.
Shakers Village is hosting their next event on Saturday, where volunteers can come out and assist with outdoor maintenance.
Fundraising takes millions of different shapes, but you may not think about canoeing as one of them. Reporter Lindsay Jones takes us to the Kentucky River for a scenic charity event that promotes Kentucky's natural beauty.
For the last month, Charity and Wilderness Appreciation took to the Kentucky River. The event series was called Paddle for a Purpose. Each Sunday, a group of nature lovers paid to cover a new 4 to 6 mile section of the river, starting from Frankfort and progressing northward in kayaks and canoes. All proceeds went directly to the Woods and Water Land Trust, which protects the Kentucky River watershed area. Riverside discussions led by local experts deepened the paddlers' understandings of the Kentucky River's rich history and vibrant ecology. Some brought their own canoes or kayaks, while others rented from the event partner, Canoe Kentucky. The director of the Woods and Water Land Trust, Heather Hausman, says that the event was more about raising awareness than it was about raising money.
It feels like it's kind of an underutilized common space, and so we thought if we could get people out here to, you know, appreciate it and enjoy it, that that would bring more attention to the work that needs to be done. So.
This was only the second annual Paddle for a Purpose event, but Hausman says that we can expect to see more events like this in the near future. In Frankfort, Kentucky, I'm Lindsay Jones for Wildcat News.
Centerpoint Christian is a small church making a big difference in our community. Saturday, they hosted an event in collaboration with Generosity Feeds where over 170 volunteers packed 15,000 meals for children struggling with food insecurity in Fayette County. This event is made possible through sponsorships with local organizations, this year including businesses such as Windstar Farm and Commonwealth Causes. Sarah Lusk, who attends Centerpoint and oversees distribution of these meals, explains how these partnerships work.
Our church is the main sponsor and we coordinate it, but the goal is to reach out into the community. So the sponsors, we ask, they donate money to help fund it. And we ask if they can to like help serve at a table to help pack. But as far as the planning and everything, we keep it to our core team.
The pouches that volunteers filled contain 2 servings of a beans and rice meal and will be distributed in schools throughout the city. A new addition this year will be a delivery to BCTC, who asked to receive a handful of meals to keep in their pantry for college students in need. Centerpoint began this meal packing event in 2018 and has been able to provide a total of 100,000 meals for people in Lexington since then. More to come on why you should stop at your favorite coffee shop tomorrow.
You've got this, okay? What they lost.
Not really. Not where it counts.
Multiple studies have shown that marijuana can slow both driver reaction
and response time, which can be really dangerous.
He's here.
He's here.
Wait, wait, wait.
What?
I can't drive.
Why?
I'm high.
Oh.
Tomorrow is National Cappuccino Day. Start your day off with a sweet Italian beverage made up of double espresso, steamed milk, and foam. Use hashtag Cappuccino Day on social media to celebrate with others. If the taste of espresso is too much for your taste buds, don't worry. You can add flavoring syrups such as vanilla, hazelnut, and more to make your perfect drink.
Will you be participating in the National Cappuccino Day?
I already have this morning. I had like 2 to get my day started. How about you?
I mean, I love coffee, but I've never had a cappuccino, actually. I normally do a latte, but I will probably be getting coffee tomorrow also.
Yes. Always got to start your day off with coffee.
Of course. That is all for your Wildcat News for today. Thank you so much for joining us.
We'll see you again next Tuesday. Have a great night.